It's a pleasure to meet and talk to students. Thank you so much.
Yes, sir. So we'll be starting. I'll just give a brief introduction, and then after that we'll start. Maybe we can wait for another 2 minutes or 3 minutes for the
Right.
students to join. Yeah.
Sure.
Thank you, sir. May I please request all the participants to kindly switch off your microphones while the session is on? Otherwise, it might create problem for the. And please do not present your screens. Just join the meeting, but do not present your screens. I think we can start by now, sir. Students, they will keep on joining
Yes.
eventually
Right.
once the
Right.
session starts. Yes, sir. So, learners, I welcome you all to this session. This session shall be headed by Dr. P. Muralidharan, professor at the School of English at Gangadhar Mehr University, Sambalpur. He offers courses in Renaissance, 20th century literature, women's writing, and Indian writing research, Indian writing and English translation. His areas of research include literature and performing arts, comparative literature, travel narratives, and post-colonial studies. Sir, we are very glad to have you amidst us, and I think I will now request you to start the session. Learners, the next voice you'll be hearing of Dr. P. Muralidhar Sharma, and he'll be the resource person for today. May I please request you to switch off your microphones while the session is going on, while the resource person is interacting with you. And once the session is over, it is open for discussion. You will be given 15 to 20 minutes to interact with the resource person. You can write your queries and questions in the chat box, and the resource person can answer to your queries. So we are good to start the session.
Thank you so much, Ananya. And I also thank the team of Orissa State Open University for inviting me for this lecture on American literature. It's always a pleasure to meet young students and discuss ideas and receive their opinions on literary texts. Now, in today's lecture, I'll be talking about American poetry, right? This is for the paper on American literature that is prescribed for the fourth semester of a postgraduate course in English at Orissa State Open University. What I'll be doing today is I'll offer a brief critical overview of 19th century American poetry, especially with reference to the poems of Walt Whitman and Emily Dickinson, the two most important poets of the 19th century and two most important poets.
Subhashri Pradhan, may I please request you to mute your microphone?
Yes.
Yeah,
So,
thank you.
Walt Whitman and Emily Dickinson are two very important voices in 19th century American poetry and two quintessentially American poets in the sense that their poetry represents a kind of a break from the European tradition, from the imitative tradition of American poetry in the 19th century, which was symbolized in the poetry of the antebellum period, of the period just before the Civil War and during the Civil War. So Walt Whitman and Emily Dickinson, through their poems, embodied a certain kind of a discontinuation of this trend of imitative poetry, where poetry was mostly an imitation of British Romantic poetry and to some extent British Victorian poetry as well. So Walt Whitman can conveniently be established as one of the very unique voices in American poetry, as also Emily Dickinson. So we'll be talking in some detail about the poems of Walt Whitman as well as Emily Dickinson. And I have deliberately chosen one male poet and one female poet so that we can look at the differences and their representation of gender as well. The end of the Civil War in the United States of America ushered in a new era in politics and creative experimentation. The war, in which the northern and southern states were divided on the question of slavery, had far-reaching consequences on the literary imaginary. The poets of the new generation, that is the mid-19th century, reassessed and rejected the motifs, themes, and techniques of the poetry of the antebellum period. However, this was a period of anxiety, uncertainty, and domestic unrest in America. New ideas entered and influenced the political, cultural, and social domains. A fresh and vigorous wave of national consciousness re-energized the entire nation. Under the leadership of the larger-than-life figure of the ambassador of change, Abraham Lincoln, democratic ideals of equality significantly influenced the domain of literary writing. And most of these changes are best embodied in the poetry of Walt Whitman, one of the most influential voices in American poetry. Now, with Walt Whitman and Emily Dickinson, as I have been arguing, American poetry acquired a creative originality of its own, a unique poetic idiom of its own. And we shall look at some of these dimensions, and we'll try to locate these features in the poems of both Whitman and Dickinson. Now, Walt Whitman's magnum opus, Leaves of Grass, that was published for the first time in 1855, remains his most significant contribution to world poetry. A work ahead of its times, Leaves of Grass has been noticed for its radicalism and pronounced rejection of convention. Whitman transformed into a kind of a revolutionary figure with the publication of his work. The work was considered unpublishable on grounds of obscenity and sexual explicitness when it appeared in public for the first time. Ralph Waldo Emerson was one of the very few to write congratulatory accounts of the work. Leaves in the title refer to pages or to bundles of paper, whereas grass was a slang term among printers for throwaway print samples. The Walt Whitman was into the printing trade. He was into the printing industry. He was into the publication industry. He worked as an apprentice in printing for a very long time. And the title Leaves of Grass also owes its origin to his connection with printing. In fact, he performed an odd variety of jobs before he started writing. He's not the kind of erudite poet that you would like to think the romantic poets to be. He was a very ordinary person who performed a variety of jobs, worked as an apprentice in printing, joined as a school teacher for a short period of time. He performed, a wide-ranging variety of jobs, which gave him exposure also to the cross-section of American society. He came in contact with the people from different levels of American society, people from different quarters of American society. So that, in fact, led to the origin of this monumental collection of poems called Leaves of Grass. The title also echoes, it has biblical echoes, reflecting Whitman's avid interest in the King James Version of the Bible. Grass in the Bible was flesh, according to this interpretation, and appropriately so, because Whitman would give prominence to the hitherto neglected human body in his collection of poems. So the human body assumes a certain kind of a centrality in Leaves of Grass. The frankness of approach that characterizes Leaves of Grass was considered too crude, to be anything close to literary and poetic profundity. The collection has come to assume a certain centrality in the works of Whitman as he kept introducing alterations to the poems, their structure and sequence, till the very end of his life. Whitman's intention was to write an American epic in three verse that he borrowed from the Bible. Leaves of Grass is an ambitious work which Whitman often compared to the Bible. Now, this work remains central to the entire oeuvre of Walt Whitman's poetry, because this is one such collection which Whitman was closely attached to, closely associated with. He was also preoccupied in revising this edition throughout his life. And the latest edition that appeared during his lifetime is called the Deathbed Edition, which appeared in 1892. So you can see to what extent he was involved in revising not just the expressions of the individual poems in this collection, but also their sequence and structure. He often rearranged these poems. So it can be argued that Walt Whitman identified himself with this collection of poems called Leaves of Grass. So this poem is crucial to understanding Walt Whitman's creative genius and also his biography. Now, Leaves of Grass is an ambitious work, about which Whitman was unambiguously ecstatic. He wrote anonymous reviews to his poems, praising his work as strikingly original, marking a creative independence from the poetry of the English. Whitman's aim was to produce a sequence of poems that encompassed all aspects of the United States of America, its history, its varied geography, its multicultural diversity, its people, and their everyday practices. The poems collected in the volume explore all aspects of American life, from the lofty to the trivial, from the extraordinary to the mundane, the poetic to the profane. In his preface to the collection, Whitman envisions a grand project and elevates himself to the status of a poet prophet of America, who carries within himself the spirit of the nation. And I quote from the preface. Now, this preface to Leaves of Grass appeared in 1855. It, of course, did not appear in the later editions of this work, but it nevertheless remains an important essay in the poetics of Walt Whitman. If you want to understand the poetics of Walt Whitman in greater details, you ought to read the lengthy preface that he wrote in 1855 to this collection. Just as we read William Wordsworth's preface to Lyrical Ballads, we ought to read the preface to Walt Whitman's Leaves of Grass, which is an ambitious poetic statement, which is an ambitious aesthetic statement. In fact, this is one such essay that talks about the evolution of a new aesthetic. It talks about the evolution of a new poetics, of a radically new poetics. I quote from the preface. Of all mankind, the great poet is the equable man. He is the equalizer of his age and land. You can see how self-conscious Whitman was of his role as a poet prophet, of his shaping role, right, in the entire project of nation building. Now, this was precisely the time when America was being imagined in terms of a nation, in terms of a unified nation, the years following the Civil War. It was for the first time that there was some kind of a compromise between the northern and the southern states of America. And America was being imagined as a unified territory, as a national terrain. So you find ideas of national consciousness and nation building in the poems of Walt Whitman. They are very pronounced. They are very explicit in the poems of Walt Whitman, especially in this collection. Now, Whitman attempts a grand poem that intends to celebrate the vitality and diversity of the human life of America. And I quote, "The United States themselves are essentially the greatest poem. Here is not merely a nation, but a teeming nation of nations," end quote. The work has an unmistakable democratic orientation, where the common people represent a unique national voice that, according to Whitman, has largely remained unsung. All wealth and military achievement is rejected in lieu of, and I quote, "the breed of full-sized men, or one full-sized man, unconquerable and simple," end quote. So you can see that Walt Whitman was out on a mission, was attempting a huge project, was attempting a grand project, where he would celebrate humanity in the American context, where he would celebrate the bodies of men and women, where he would celebrate the vitality of the human life of America, in its cultural, historical context. Although the first edition of the book does not carry the name of the author, after about 500 lines of the poem, the poet introduces himself as Walt Whitman, an American, one of the roughs, a cosmos, disorderly, fleshy and sensual, no sentimentalist, no standard above men or women, or apart from them, no more modest than immodest. You can see this entire statement by which he introduces himself. So he identifies himself with the common people of America. There's a certain element of ordinariness in his self-description. You can see that he doesn't, he punctures the notion of, the romantic notion of the creative genius as unique and different from the ordinary. You can think of S.T. Coleridge's notion of the artist as he, represented in his poem, Kubla Khan, right? You can think of the concluding lines of Kubla Khan. Weave a circle round him thrice and close your eyes in holy dread, for he on honeydew hath fed and drunk the milk of paradise. So this is the romantic notion of the creative genius, where the creative genius, the poet, is different from the ordinary, is different from common men and women. But Walt Whitman had a radically new vision for the poet, right? He conceptualized the role of a poet in a completely different manner, where he identifies the poet as one among the ordinary people. So the poet was not a unique or a gifted being. He is one among the laity. He was one among the pedestrian people. Later in his life, Whitman described the book as an epic of democracy. Whitman was influenced by the democratic ideals of Abraham Lincoln, whom he iconized in poems like When the Lilacs Last in the Dooryard Bloomed and O Captain, My Captain. These are two very important poems from the collection where Walt Whitman is idealized, where Abraham Lincoln is iconized, right? Whitman's democratic consciousness admits heterogeneity and recognizes the plurality of life in America. He emerges as an advocate of egalitarianism. He accords due respect to the status of the individual, unmediated by the categories of race, class, region, or gender. The relationship of the individual to the whole, of one to all, is envisioned, is explored in these poems, right? So this equation between the individual, between the isolated, individual was not an isolated entity, but a part of the whole, but a part of the segregates, right, that we call the nation. So you can see that this conception of, this relationship, this equation of the individual to the whole, of one to all, of the segregated individual to the aggregate called the nation, is explored in these poems. Now, although Whitman wrote at a time when differences still existed, he envisioned a future where such boundaries would vanish. He viewed America as an undifferentiated mass of people, where the narrow categories that kept them apart would melt in the newly emerging aggregate of the nation. Whitman's egalitarian outlook is reflected in the choice of themes, from the conventionally poetic to the conventionally obscene, from the beautiful to the ugly. So you find such juxtapositions in the collection, in the poems that have been anthologized in this collection. So the ugly and the beautiful would be fused together, would be juxtaposed with each other. Similarly, the poetic and the profane, right? The profound and the profane, the serious and the not so serious, right? The lofty and the trivial. So all these contraries are fused together in the poems, which have been collected in Leaves of Grass. Language also varies from the grand and dignified to the ordinary street slang. Whitman was discontented with the superficial expressions and sugared conceits of his contemporaries and wrote in a rough, crude, unrefined, but nevertheless sincere style, right? So he was largely dissatisfied with the sugared conceits, with the embellishments, the poetic embellishments that were introduced into poetry by most of his contemporaries as well as his predecessors, both American and English. So this satisfaction is voiced in his rejection of these ornamentations, right? These embellishments. So his poetry is direct, rough, crude, often abrupt. It shocks the readers, but it is nevertheless sincere, right? Take, for example, the following passage from his poem, Miracles, right? I'll read out this passage from that poem. The title of the poem is Miracles, and it begins with a very abrupt question. Why? Who makes much of a miracle? Look at the conversational style in which the poem begins. It's written in a colloquial style. The language of ordinary conversation is used for this poem. So it has a very abrupt beginning. It begins with a casual questioning. It reverses the meaning of miracles, which are extraordinary happenings. The miracles are unusual and extraordinary happenings. But here, Whitman attempts to, Whitman tries to suggest that miracles are not extraordinary happenings. They are extremely ordinary happenings in a nation like America. Every aspect of the life of America is a miracle. Everything about America is a miracle. And miracles happen, every moment in a nation like America. So it begins with this very direct, abrupt, and bold question. Why? Who makes much of a miracle? And then a little later in the poem, he tries to fuse the beautiful and the ugly, the lofty and the trivial, the attractive and the repulsive in the following lines. Or watch honeybees busy around the hive of a summer forenoon, or animals feeding in the fields, or birds, or the wonderfulness of insects in the air, or the wonderfulness of the sun down, or of stars shining so white and bright, or the exquisite, delicate, thin curve of the new moon in spring, or whether I go among those I like best and that like me best, mechanics, boatmen, farmers, or among the savants, or to the soiree, or to the opera, or stand a long while looking at the movements of machinery, or behold children at their sports, or the admirable sight of the perfect old man, or the perfect old woman, or the sick in hospitals, or the dead carried to burial, or my own eyes and figure in the glass. These with the rest, one and all, are to be miracles, the whole referring, yet each distinct and in its place. You can see that this poem offers a catalogue of miracles, right? It contains a lengthy description. It contains a lengthy list. It's a long list of miracles that usually happen in America. So everything about American life, culture, American history, its landscape is a miracle. And you see that the conventionally poetic images of the honeybees or the birds, or for example, the exquisite, delicate, thin curve of the new moon in spring, which are all conventional romantic images that convey an idea of beauty, have been juxtaposed with ugly images of old men and women, of the sick in hospitals, or the dead carried to burial, right? So you can see that the beautiful and ugly have been juxtaposed with each other. There are morbid images of death and disease that have been juxtaposed with the beautiful. So images which frequently recur in romantic poetry, like honeybees, for example, birds, for example, you can think of a range of evocations. You can think of Ode to the Nightingale, to the Skylark, William Wordsworth's Cuckoo. So you have a whole range of references to birds in romantic poetry. Similarly, honeybees or the new moon in spring. Spring, for example, is celebrated in romantic poetry. Now, all of these images are cancelled by the appearance immediately after of ugly images of disease, of death, of aging. And look at these expressions, perfect old man and perfect old woman, right? Which are oxymorons, because perfection and old age do not go together, right? Now, old age in romantic poetry is always evocative of death because of its proximity to death. It is usually an unpoetic attribute, right? Romantic poetry, moves away from old age. There is a tendency in romantic poets to escape old age, right? To embody and escape, from old age through their movement to the past, looking back, through the act of looking back at the past. So these ideas are rejected, right? And the beautiful is celebrated, as well as the ugly, the deadly, the diseased, morbid is also celebrated. So you find such interesting, ways of puncturing, romantic versions of poetry, romantic notions of poetry in the poems of Walt Whitman. His poetry is imbued with a certain kind of inclusiveness that embraces the most common and unpoetic of things around him. It is in this respect that his poetry defies conventions and strikes a new chord. Whitman also had a strong distaste for the kind of poetry his predecessors and contemporaries were writing, one that attempted to glorify the distant phenomena of classical Europe at the cost of its own rich cultural legacy and the throbbing present. In his Song of the Exposition, he writes, and I quote, "Come, Muse, migrate from Greece and Ionia. Cross out, please, those immensely overpaid accounts, that matter of Troy and Achilles' wrath, and Aeneas' and Odysseus' wanderings. Placard removed and too late on the rocks of your snowy Parnassus. For know that a better, fresher, busier sphere, a wider, untried domain awaits, demands you." So he urges the poets of his time to move away from descriptions of the phenomena of classical Europe, to move away from this preoccupation with Europe or European cultural legacy to American cultural legacy, right? He urges the poets of his time to talk about America, to write about America, to focus on the unsung aspects of American culture and life. He says, this is a fresher, busier sphere, a wider, untried domain, right? Which is eagerly awaiting the poetic touch, which is eagerly awaiting to enter into the domain of poetry. Whitman's poetry is also unique in that it celebrates the body in a way no other poet of his time does. In poems like I Sing the Body Electric, he is involved in a bold, frank, and unapologetic glorification of the human body, which is invested with a certain kind of a centrality in his scheme of things. He reacted strongly and sensitively to the commodification of the body, either in the slave trade or in the flesh trade, both of which were recurring motifs in Leaves of Grass. There is a specific seriousness attributed to sensuality and eroticism, which, according to Whitman, were the most crucial, indispensable attributes of human existence. So like other poets, he doesn't shirk away, he doesn't move away or try to conceal his sexual longings, right? He gives an open expression to sensuality and eroticism. And these are recurring ideas in many of his poems, but in a more pronounced way, in a more explicit way, in this particular poem, I Sing the Body Electric. Whitman's poetry celebrates both heterosexual and homosexual love, the latter being an indication of his own sexual inclination. Now, many critics consider Whitman to be a homosexual, right? So there are traces of homoeroticism in the calamus cluster of poems in the Leaves of Grass. Leaves of Grass was later restructured, modified into various clusters, right? And the calamus cluster of poems in Leaves of Grass contains traces of Whitman's homoeroticism. And I quote from this poem, I Sing the Body Electric. O my body, I dare not desert the likes of you in other men and women, nor the likes of the parts of you. I believe the likes of you are to stand or fall with the likes of the soul, and that they are the soul. I believe the likes of you shall stand or fall with my poems, and that they are my poems. Man's, woman's, child's, youth's, wife's, husband's, mother's, father's, young man's, young woman's poems. Head, neck, hair, ears, drop and tympan of the ears, eyes, eye fringes, iris of the eye, eyebrows and the waking or sleeping of the lids, mouth, tongue, lips, teeth, roof of the mouth, jaws and the jaw hinges, nose, nostrils of the nose and the partition, cheeks, temples, forehead, chin, throat, back of the neck, neck loop, strong shoulders, manly beard, scapula, hind shoulders, and the ample side round of the chest, upper arm, armpit, elbow socket, lower arm, arm sinews, arm bones, wrist and wrist joints, hand, palm, knuckles, thumb, forefinger, finger joints, fingernails, broad breast front, curling hair of the breast, breastbone, breast side, ribs, belly, backbone, joints of the backbone, hips, hip sockets, hip strength, inward and outward round, man balls, man root, strong set of thighs, well carrying the trunk above, leg fibers, knee, knee pan, upper leg, under leg, ankles, instep, football, toes, toe joints, the heel, Now you can see there's a lengthy and exhaustive list of even the minutest part of the human body, right? No part of the human body has been ignored in this poem. It is a catalogue of each and every inch of the human body that is celebrated in this poem, right? Now, which other poet of his time or after him celebrates the human body in this fashion, in this frank, bold fashion, where even the most tiny part of the human body becomes a part of poetry, right? Now, each of these beautiful as well as ugly parts of the human body, the private parts of the human body especially, which have never been subjects of poetry, are being celebrated in this poem, I Sing the Body Electric. And it concludes in a very interesting way. It says, oh, I say, these are not the parts and poems of the body only, but of the soul. Oh, I say now, these are the soul. So he tries to merge the body and the soul. He rejects the binarism, the conventional binarism between the body and the soul, between the corporeal and the spiritual. And he tends to argue that the body is the soul. Each and every part of the body is invested with spiritual energy. It is not really possible to separate the body and the soul, to talk about them as if they were separate entities. They are inseparable. They are inextricably intertwined with each other. So the poem, as you can see, engages in a very bold and unapologetic eulogization of the corporeal, right? The human body, both male and female, is celebrated in its totality. Whitman uses the anatomy of the human body to formulate a new poetics of the body, where human body parts are invested with aesthetic attributes. Whitman's poetry also reflects a fascination for the city. Images of urban life in all their variety populate the poems in Leaves of Grass. His poems embody a significant departure from the prevalent romantic worldview that perceived the city as corrupting and the rural domain as innocent and free. Now, this kind of a division in romantic poetry, conceives of the city as a center of corruption, right? You can see it's very pronounced in the poems of William Wordsworth, right? And the rural domain is innocent, pure, pristine, and simple. It symbolizes freedom in its best form, and so on. So this kind of a binary is punctured by Walt Whitman, because he also tends to celebrate the city. There are images of urban life, there are images of urban landscape that frequently recur in the poems of Walt Whitman. He's quite often hailed as the poet of urban America, right? He's a predominantly urban kind of a poet. Although he talked about the rural domain, he talked about the coasts of America. The coasts of America, are usually the setting for many of his poems. But he's predominantly a poet of the city, right? There's an undeniable urban aspect to many of the poems of Walt Whitman. And in doing so, he anticipates later poets, the poets of the 20th century, like T.S. Eliot, Marion Moore, or Allen Ginsberg, whose poetry was preoccupied with the urban landscape, right? You can think of T.S. Eliot's The Wasteland, or for example, Love Song of J. Alfred Prufrock, or Preludes, all of which carry images of urban life, right? The urban landscape, the urban domain provides a backdrop for representation of cultural decay and disintegration. Same with Allen Ginsberg's Howl, which is a very important collection of poetry, one of the important classics of American literature. Now, the following passage from Crossing Brooklyn Ferry, another very important poem of Walt Whitman, illustrates his preoccupation with urban life. Thrive, cities, bring your fright, bring your shows, ample and sufficient rivers. Expand, being than which none else is perhaps more spiritual. Keep your places, objects than which none else is more lasting. So this particular passage begins with the word, with the expression, thrive cities, right? You can see that cities or the urban domain is projected as very promising, as expanding. He wants the urban domain to expand. He wants the urban domain to survive, right? He wants the cities to thrive, right? He wants urban life to continue its throbbing pulsation. So he is predominantly a poet of the city, as we say, for example, that T.S. Eliot is a poet of the city, or Allen Ginsberg is a poet of the city. Now, whereas the poems of Walt Whitman were predominantly public in their orientation because they talked about public life, they were open outwards, right? The poetry of Emily Dickinson, who was writing immediately after he wrote his major collections, was turned inward, right? The major difference between Walt Whitman and Emily Dickinson is that the poems of Walt Whitman are more public in their orientation. They are turned outward. They talk about external affairs. They are preoccupied with externality of human life. Whereas the poetry of Emily Dickinson is turned inward, right? It is modeled more as an exploration of the consciousness. These are the poems of the soul, whereas the poems of Walt Whitman were mostly the poems of the body, especially the collection Leaves of Grass, where he sings the body. If Walt Whitman sings of the body, Emily Dickinson sings of the soul. And this is the major difference between the two. They're complete contraries to each other. The poetic domain of Emily Dickinson comprised of the inner world of her own spiritual being. Introspection became one of the chief poetic devices for her. Most of her poems were written in the form of introspections, written in the form of private musings. Now, Emily Dickinson was born in Amherst, Massachusetts, which was a New England town. She lived a major part of her life as a recluse, right? She rarely interacted with people beyond her family. She spent a substantial part of her life in isolation, and this contributed in a significant way to the themes of many of her poems, which are turned inward, which are internalized debates about the soul, about death, about different dimensions of life. For example, her poems were posthumously published, right? When you look at her poems, you get an impression that these are the poems which were probably not intended for publication, because most of these poems appeared on letters that she exchanged with her close friends, with just a few people. She had a very close circle of friends, of which her sister-in-law was one, Sister Shu, right? Suzanne Dickinson, her sister-in-law, was one of her closest friends. And very recently, critics are talking about homosexual inclinations between Emily Dickinson and her dear sister Sue. So, and she also exchanged a couple of letters with Higginson, for example, and Mabel Todd, publishers whom she knew very well. So she was exchanging poems in the form of letters. So these poems of Emily Dickinson should also be read alongside her private correspondences, right? Because these poems are written in the form of epistolary exchange. Many of her poems use this medium of epistolary exchange, use the structure of epistolary exchange. So in the case of Emily Dickinson, her poems cannot be read as separate from her correspondences. They cannot be separated from her epistolary exchanges with the select group of friends and family members. The recurring themes of her poems include death and immortality. If Whitman is preoccupied with life, Dickinson is preoccupied with death, right? Death and immortality. Now, Whitman celebrated life with a gusto, as you have seen. He celebrates life in a spirited, vibrant, and energetic way, whereas Dickinson's poems are more serious, somber, and say the less obvious about life. Whitman's poems say the most obvious about life, whereas Dickinson's poems say the least obvious details of life. So her poems and letters hardly help us to construct her life as she lived it. They are guarded by a certain device that retains their secrecy and confidentiality. So secrecy and confidentiality are two important elements of the works of Emily Dickinson. These elements help us to understand not just her poetry, but also her epistolary exchanges. It is difficult to ascertain whether her poetry gave expression to repression, to repression or lived experience, which is still a question that is being debated. right? So did she express her life, or did she talk about the repressed side of life, right? Whether her poetry is a form of expression or repression is still a debate among critics. The questions pertaining to God, man, nature, love and death are explored in many of her poems with a rare intimacy. There is an intimate understanding of love and of death in many of her poems. The repression of desire is a prominent subtext in many of the poems of Emily Dickinson. Her poems reveal the tension experienced by an unmarried woman whose life was restricted and full of unrealized passions. Now, Emily Dickinson did not marry, right? She died a spinster. So these repressed passions, these unrealized passions form an integral aspect of her poetry. Her poetry is to be read against a life which never had access to these passions, which could never really experience these passions in their fullness. The notion of love or passion that is voiced in her poems is one that results out of repression, right? Many of her letters, as I said, are addressed to her sister-in-law, in whom Dickinson confided. She also experienced failure in love from a young lawyer in her father's office. This is a lover with whom she also corresponded by writing imaginary letters, by addressing a number of imaginary letters. Although Dickinson might have composed her poems with an intention for them to be read, she could never manage to reach out to the publishers on her own terms. The people from whom she sought advice were her sister Sue, Mabel Todd, Samuel Bowles, Helen Hunt Jackson, and Josiah Holland, with whom she shared her poems. Thomas Higginson and Mabel Todd later published her poems in print, but only after significantly altering them. This is another important dimension of the poetry of Emily Dickinson. Most of her poems were altered structurally as well as sequentially by many of her publishers. They considered her poems, some of her poems, not fit for publication because they were written in a completely different kind of an idiom, a kind of an idiom which was not popularly known amongst readers of the time, because her poems are very, will give you an experience of shock when you read them for the first time. They also have very abrupt beginnings. They also have very abrupt endings, for example. So this is a kind of poetry that shocks more than pleases. And she also uses unconventional rhyme scheme, unconventional rhythms in her poems. Her word choices are very, very unique. The arrangement of words is very unique. She invests individual words with very unique kind of semantic connotations. She attaches the less obvious connotations of words while she uses them in poetry. Her method of incorporating meaning into her words was highly unconventional, as I said. They are rich with plurality and suggestiveness. There's not one way in which you can interpret the poems of Emily Dickinson. They can be read in several ways. The understanding of the implications of words, for Emily Dickinson was very subtle and complex, right? Her understanding of words and the way that words give rise to meaning was very, very different from the ordinary perception. Skepticism and doubt is often voiced in the poetry of Emily Dickinson. Her work is considered to be highly original, primarily due to her rejection of conventional forms of versification, use of unusual off-rhymes. She patterned many of her poems after the hymns of the 18th century hymnist Isaac Watts. She was influenced by the 18th century hymnist Isaac Watts, and most of her poems are modeled after these hymns. Other important attributes of her poetry include the epigrammatic compression, personal or the intimate voice, the frankness and boldness in approaching her subject. Most of these poems are very somber to the core. They are written mostly in solitude. Her juvenilia, right, the works which she composed before she came of age, in her teenage, are also quite important in understanding her, the development of her mind. Her juvenilia and her letters should be read alongside her poems. Now, most of the poems in general can understand them as expressions of a painful personal crisis that resulted out of her failed romantic relationships, right? Now, Emily Dickinson was not the only woman writer of the time. She at least had one professional woman writer as a predecessor. That was Anne Bradstreet, the 17th century Puritan woman, poet Anne Bradstreet, who wrote a number of poems, where she imagined herself as a professional writer, right? She understood the world and her roles as a woman in very conventional terms, unlike Emily Dickinson. But she's also one of the first American woman poets who thought of herself as a professional, right? So Anne Bradstreet's poems, especially the author to her book, or for example, Prologue, where she expresses her self-consciousness about being a woman poet, right? Where she tries to strike a difference from the poetry of men, is very significant. These are the poems where she involves Anne Bradstreet, involves herself in a detailed metaphorical description of the birth of the book, its publication, right? Where she draws comparison between writing by women and writing by men, uses the metaphors of motherhood, birthing, and nursing to talk about poetry. I think I should read at least some parts of the poems of Anne Bradstreet, who's not a very well-known poet, right? Usually, courses, academic courses like the UG or PG level do not include the poems of Anne Bradstreet, who's nevertheless a very, very significant woman poet of the 17th century, and of course, a predecessor of Emily Dickinson. In fact, Emily Dickinson would have borrowed many of her themes, motifs, and symbols from Anne Bradstreet. I'll just read out a small excerpt from a poem called Prologue, the first poem in an entire series of collection by Bradstreet. To sing of wars, of captains, and of kings, of cities founded, commonwealths begun, for my mean pen are two superior things, or how they all, or each their dates have run. Let poets and historians set these forth. My obscure lines shall not so dim their worth, right? And a little later she says, from schoolboy's tongue no rhetoric we expect, nor yet a sweet consort from broken strings, nor perfect beauty where's a main defect. My foolish, broken, blemished muse so sings, and this to mend, alas, no art is able, 'cause nature made it so irreparable. You can see there's a self-consciousness about her inferiority in creative terms, right? So she tries to talk about the common premises of male poets, male idiom of poetry, their thematic preoccupations, and explores the question of power, wars, politics, which are all grand narratives of civilizations. She's talking about the exclusive prerogative of men, that to sing of wars, of history, of nations, is the prerogative of men. These are things which are not so fit for women, which are unfit for women, right? So you can see she writes in an unassuming vein, right? There's a constructed humility, there's a strategic submissiveness. She undermines her literary achievement. She talks about her imperfections, flaws, and failures. And these flaws, she argues, are inherent to women artists, right? So a woman artist will nevertheless write with these flaws, failures, and imperfections. So this kind of a self-conscious approach to writing poetry is also to be found in the poems of Emily Dickinson, right? She's very conscious of being a woman poet, who's battling with certain contradictions of her life, who's making several compromises with her life in writing poetry. For example, you find such the echoes of this kind of inward debate in her poem, They Shut Me Up in Prose, a very well-known poem by Emily Dickinson. They shut me up in prose, right? Now, poetry for Dickinson symbolized a terrain of immense possibility. Prose was manly, whereas poetry was feminine, right? Prose was captivating, confining. It did not allow her creative powers to be nurtured. Poetry was liberating, a symbol of freedom from the mundaneness of prose. The prose as plain, simple, dull, matter-of-fact, and unimaginative did not allow a woman writer to break the confines of conventional poetics. So she draws a difference between poetry and prose, where she suggests that poetry is the domain of the woman, because it allows a woman artist to express herself more freely, to express herself in an uninhibited manner. Although her poems are not that bold and frank, they are turned inward, they are more statements of repression than of expression. So most of her poems are very eccentric, and at times the persona that emerges from these poems is very enigmatic, right? Her poems embody a certain kind of a private sphere, that of epistolary correspondence, rather than the public sphere of books and journals. There's a certain visual aspect to many of the poems of Dickinson. Their placement on the page, in her letters, the dashes of varying lengths, the unusual capitalization and word choices, the unusual idiom, were often considered to be her unique contributions to poetry. So her poems also had a visual dimension about them. She made unconventional use of punctuation, especially the dashes of varying lengths that add meaning, that are integral to the message of many of her poems. Similarly, the placement of the poem in a page, or for example, the placement of a particular poem in one of her letters, which she exchanged with the close circle of friends. So her poems had an undeniable visual aspect to them. The way they appeared on a page were also was also significant. And in these respects, in terms of the stylistic innovations that she introduced into poetry, she's considered to be a pre-modernist poet, right? One of the precursors of poets like Sylvia Plath, or for example, T.S. Eliot. So she's considered to be a pre-modernist in that sense, in terms of her rebelliousness, right? And most of her poems also, embody varying voices. There are abrupt, sudden beginnings. There's a multiplicity of voices. There is a multitude of self-positionings, right? The poet persona takes on various subject positions where gender is, inactive. Dickinson also, rebelled in her own way, in her own subtle, nuanced way. She rebelled against the patriarchal, religious, suppression of the spirit of the woman writer. And this happens to be an interesting aspect of her poetry. There are traces of confessional tone in many of her poems. These are outpourings of personal experiences, private feelings on love, death, nature, and immortality. Scenes are dramatized in the poems of Emily Dickinson. Even inanimate, even abstract ideas like immortality, death, for example, are all personified in many of her poems. They exchange dialogues with each other. So scenes, her internal debates, the debates raging within her mind are all dramatized with the use of dialogue, with personification. So there is a dramatization of a scene, a state of mind, perceptions of imagined speakers. So she assumes various personas in the course of the poems. These poems also deal with existential dilemmas, right? Problems of existence that are echoed in her verse. Her existentialist sensibility is reflected in many of her poems. Her skepticism, self-doubt, and rebelliousness are important attributes of her poems. And most of these, rebelliousness was directed against established religion and social order, as well as patriarchy, right? Now, religion and society were the domains of the patriarchal order. So she rebelled against them in her own subtle poetic way. It was not an open or a bold rebellion, as in the case of Sylvia Plath, for example, a later day poet. So if you look at these three important woman poets of America, Anne Bradstreet, Emily Dickinson, and her successor Sylvia Plath, you can see how women's writing, how poetry by women also underwent significant changes in terms of themes as well as style. There's a certain kind of a continuity, as you can see. So you can consider Anne Bradstreet to be a kind of a foremother of American women's poetry, because she was one of the first professional women to produce poetry in New England. So I think, in my opinion, these three poems should be read together. If you want to understand the poems of Emily Dickinson, you ought to read them against the poems of Anne Bradstreet as well as Sylvia Plath. There's a greater boldness, frankness. There's a greater tone of rebellion in the poems of Sylvia Plath, which is very pronounced, which is very explicit. Whereas this tone of rebellion against patriarchy, her discontentment with patriarchy, is less pronounced, more implicit than explicit, more subtle and nuanced in the poems of Emily Dickinson. And if you go back to Anne Bradstreet, I think there's hardly any tone of rebellion, right? She's in absolute conformity with the patriarchal order. Although in that particular poem, Prologue, she's trying to write a different kind of a poetry where she considers herself to be inferior, where she considers her talent to be inferior to that of male poets, which is in itself a strategy of protest, right? So this kind of, this assuming of, assuming creative inferiority is a kind of a protest, right? Is a kind of a professional protest that she's mounting through that particular poem. So I think with this, we can wind up the discussion. We have looked at Walt Whitman and Emily Dickinson and some of their poems, which are quintessentially American poems in terms of originality, in terms of creative originality, right? These are the poems which rarely, imitate their English predecessors, as most of their contemporary poets did. So Walt Whitman and Emily Dickinson, in my opinion, can be considered to be truly American voices in poetry, right? The quintessentially American poets, one man, the other woman. And you can also see the striking difference between the domains that they inhabited. One had a predominantly public existence, at least in poetry. The other had, an undeniable private existence, right? So these are the two different, very contrasting domains that they inhabited, that they talked about in their poems. And I think with that, I think we should conclude today's session. Thank you so much for a patient hearing. Thank you so much for hosting the lecture. If you have questions, you can certainly ask them.
Hello. I'm so sorry. My phone was disconnected at the right time. Extremely sorry. So thank you, sir. I was present. I have heard your entire lecture, and it was really helpful and beneficial. I hope the learners had got a lot of benefit from today's lecture. Now, I would like to request the learners to write the questions and the queries they have in the chat box. Learners, you can put your queries and your questions in the chat box. No questions? No queries? Or if you want, you can directly interact with the resource person also, if you have any doubts. No queries.
No queries.
So maybe then you have explained them so well that they do not have any queries. Thank you so much for this. And it was a very beneficial lecture. And I hope that we further shake hands for such interactions and collaborations with our university. And it was great having you amidst us, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. I think the participants will feel inspired to read the poems of both Whitman and Dickinson. And maybe after that,
they will definitely, sir. Definitely, definitely.
They will certainly have questions at that point of time when they read the poems. And
right, sir. Right, sir. Right, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Sure. Yes, sir. With this, we call it a day. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. Yeah.